Now, here, what actually we're going to talk today is about the customer success stories, as well as the best practices that we kind of got from all our previous experience and the current live migrations that we are doing with customers. So with that, I would quickly like to switch on our first customer story, which is for Capita Reading Cloud. And this customer is...
So have you been involved with these customers directly?
Oh, yeah. So,
oh, really?
Yeah, so we are actively involved with these customers because these are the migration customers and they are part of our engineering program support. So we kind of work with them pretty much like shoulder to shoulder.
Okay.
And with this particular customer, the key thing was that as part of their migration journey, the biggest problem statement was that they were running on a third-party hosted solution, which is having their SQL Server state. And they have 8,000-plus, I would say, libraries, which are supporting student all across the UK. So that's like one of the biggest setup with 10,000-plus customer databases.
Okay.
And
10,000-plus?
Yeah, I said it. 10,000-plus customer databases.
Okay.
And you can understand, like, migrating such customer databases is, like, really challenging from multiple perspectives. But the best part was that when we got engaged with them, we understood what the problem statement was because they were really not able to scale with the third-party solution on-prem. And that is where, like, they said that, hey, we want to go to Azure, where, like, we can get that manageability, flexibility, and we can go ahead and scale at our will in an easy way. And we got engaged. We started working with them, and we found that actually Azure SQL Database Elastic Pool is best suitable option for them. Now, the platform was logged. The actual part was the migration journey. And the best part was that customer was having only 2 days in a week as the window to go and do the migration.
Okay.
Because they are library, they are live, and over the weekend they are available for the migration. And with 10,000 plus databases, it is not an easy thing to go. And what we did as part of the migration was that we helped them to go with the first set of first-party tools, which are Data Migration Assistant and Data Migration Services.
Yep.
And with a combination of this, actually, we made them successful in their overall migration. Now, if I double-click on that and take kind of this a little further, we initially got engaged with a couple of database migration, and we saw that going one database at a time is not an easy way. And
you mean we should not be running DMA 10,000 times?
Yes, that would have been kind of like a very, very slow process.
Yeah.
So what we did was that we optimized things for them depending on the number of databases. We, for the DMA, which kind of goes and converts the schema as well as programmable objects, we got a PowerShell script kind of worked for them where, like, they can take all the databases and migrate the schema and programmable objects in one go.
Yeah.
And then run DMS, which is like Azure Data Migration Services on top of that for their actual data migration.
Okay.
And the way we did this was that, like, pretty much we took 400 databases batch every weekend.
Okay.
And we did the schema migration, and the DMS was ready with all the databases selected. And think in a way that in their team, somebody was sitting, and, like, finally, before the weekend starts, they hit the DMS button, start, and all the 400 database migration starts.
Oh,
and,
nice.
Like, it goes over the weekend. There was nobody supposed to go and monitor it.
Yeah.
Even if there was one or two databases failing, that was fine because DMS is having this fantastic and beautiful feature that it skips, like, failing databases and goes and migrates and rest of that stuff.
Okay.
So that way, actually, they achieved this, like, big target of 10,000-plus databases migration over a very short duration of time.
That's awesome.
So this was, like, a great migration journey, but at the same time, there were certain best practices, which was for customers as well for us also. So if I may highlight, one of the key thing was that...
Yes, please.
In Azure Data Migration Services, at the time when we were working with them, we found that because each instance was having, let's say, 1,000-plus databases out there, and when you go to the DMS UI, you open the UI to kind of select the set of databases which you want to migrate, the problem that was happening was that UI was freezing because all the databases list was not loading. So at that time, at least, we gave them a workaround that let's take a user who is only having access to your 400 databases batches which you want to migrate. And then we go in DMS and everything started working, which means like 400 databases, boom. And that is how the migration happened. But that became one of, I would say, the feedback for our tool, which we took and eventually incorporated in DMS. And now in DMS, we have the paging feature, which means like...
Paging.
The pagination, which means like you have the pages where you have, even if 10,000 or more than that databases, you can still be able to see them in the DMS UI, but in the paginated mode.
That makes sense.
So that way, like this customer was very successful in their overall migration journey. And they followed the best practices that we kind of gave them. So it's like a fantastic case study, which is available to public on our public website.
On our website?
Yeah.
Okay, so next one is H&R Block.
That's right. So let's talk about the next one, which is H&R Block. And this is, again, I would say, feather in the cap in terms of like how we did migration. And there was a reason that I selectively chose Capita and H&R Block because these have two different flavors of migration of customers. While Capita was having its own DNA, which means like they had a small window of migration, which is like over the weekend. With H&R Block, if people know, especially I would say in United States, if we are taxpayers, we know H&R Block. That is how it is.
Exactly.
And with H&R Block, the best part is the seasonality. We have to really understand customer seasonality. So they have a tax season, which is pretty much like starting January
to
April, May at the max. And after that, actually, there is a lean period for them. And they use that as an opportunity kind of go for their database migration and modernization.
Okay.
And with H&R Block, what we did was that they had a homogeneous and a heterogeneous source systems and application available there. And the approach that we took with them was that like a step-by-step approach. Because you can understand that there are customers who are in the financial domains and places like that.
Mm-hmm.
For them, going to cloud is not like one straightforward jump sometimes. And they have to take a step-by-step approach. We really kind of worked with them and made sure that their first application, which was their data warehouse, a big data warehouse running on legacy platforms like NetEase and AS400, MPP platforms.
Yeah.
We took that and we first tested that as a proof of concept for them on SQL Server 2017 on-prem, which is a SMP platform. And the numbers which came as the performance numbers were fantastic.
Okay.
It was fabulous. That gave a confidence to them. And then we moved them from NetEase and AS400 to SQL 2017 on-prem as a step one.
Okay.
Now, let's keep in mind that in all this migration, the actual core migration was done by H&R Block internal team itself.
Yeah.
Microsoft was providing their production oversight. And what we found as a best practice was because there are very limited first-party tools to kind of migrate from legacy platform like NetEase and AS400. We recommended them a combination of first-party tools like SSIS and our own internal custom scripts to third-party tools as a combination to go and migrate. Now, the challenging part in this particular migration was that they had their warehouse running up and running from multi-year, I would say a decade. And they wanted to go live with the new system. So we recommended them as a best practice, let's have things running in parallel. So both the environments were running in parallel. All the data was syncing from their legacy environment to the 2017 on-prem. And when all the functional testing was done, we performed a final cutover back in October 2018.
The application cutover to
this. Yes. And that way, like the whole migration was successful. And now it's already one tax season, and everything is working like a charm for them. And this, as I said, like this is the step one. Their migration.
Yeah.
Because they moved from at least legacy platform to SQL Server on-prem. Now with that, the confidence was gained that, hey, this platform can take our load, and there are so many features which we can leverage.
Especially coming from MPP to SMP, like you have to have confidence.
That's right. Yeah. And like people have very, I would say, skeptical thought process when you're coming from MPP to SMP because they are entirely different architecture. But SQL really proved it. That,
okay.
Yes, we can take that type of a load.
I'm curious about the next step. Then what happened?
Yeah. And as a next step, then we took their DIY system, which is like do-it-yourself tech taxing, and they call that as e-file. So which means like people who want to go and file their online taxes, they can use the system. And they took that piece of the system along with the tax appointment system to Azure.
Okay.
And in Azure, we help them to take that in the SQL VM first.
Okay.
So now they are running in
again,
SQL VM.
Again, IaaS, next step.
So as an IaaS, you see the next step. And this is where I call that as like a journey.
Yeah.
So they are performing that journey. And on SQL IaaS, they are running this as like a complete distributed availability zone on the Azure. Plus, they have one of their asynchronous replica running on-prem so that like they have a complete HADR availability for them. And this application is taking like complete load and running fantastic. And with that, now this is proven as a next step. Now they are migrating their other set of applications to Azure SQL database. As well as Azure SQL Managed Instance.
As a PaaS offering.
As a PaaS offering. So you see, like, this is a gradual shift from a customer perspective, taking step one, step two, and step three. And pretty much I would say now this is kind of a mandate in H&R Block that all the applications which are running right now there, they are trying to move all of them as either Azure SQL PaaS, or if not SQL PaaS, then on SQL VM.
Okay.
So that is how actually this whole migration journey is for H&R Block. Yeah.
Thanks for sharing. Yeah, now, what are some of the best practices? You know, I know you work with lots of customers.
Right. Yeah. So glad that you're asking this question. So let me kind of quickly jump on the next slide. And there are, I would say, quite a lot of best practices. But from certain key best practices perspective, I would say that customers have to, if I'm a customer, I would want to know that, you know, what is the migration path for me? And from a migration, best migration path perspective, as I said, like, you have to understand the seasonality of the business that you are in. And depending on that, we have an online migration path as well as an offline migration path. So you have to really carefully assess that particular piece, and then based on that, choose an online versus offline. And the best part is that for both of your paths, Microsoft is having its set of first-party tools which can help you migrate. Be it like Data Migration Assistant, Azure Data Migration Services, and things like that to your online migration pieces. So that's one of the best practices I would recommend. And second comes, are there any migration accelerators available? Hmm. So the migration accelerators, as I talked about, like first-party accelerators, but there are certain cases where like you're coming from some legacy platforms where first-party toolings are not the one which are going to be directly supporting you. Then, of course, we have our third-party partner toolings available, which you can go ahead and leverage and kind of make your migration journey.
Okay.
And then we have high availability and disaster recovery requirements. Customers often have this question that how can I achieve high availability and disaster recovery? That is through our Azure PaaS services, because by default, Azure offers you 4.9 high availability and disaster recovery solutions. So yeah, these are some of them, but we have loads of that, and which is available on our Azure Data Migration Guide, I would say.
Okay.
I recommend our customers to go and look at Azure Data Migration Guide, and we have a complete path available which they can go ahead and use for their migration.
So can you explain one of these to me? Like, what are we looking at this in this picture?
Yeah. So one of these is like, if you are migrating, let's say, from Oracle to Azure SQL Database, in case if you want to migrate from Oracle to Azure SQL Database, anyone can go to our datamigration.microsoft.com website, and they can select that, you know, if this is my use case scenario of migration, there is a complete step-by-step process and guide provided there, which means like as a step one, pre-migration, what you're supposed to do, you have to go and run SSMA, SQL Server Migration Assistant. You take schema, programmable objects, then migrate that piece. Then as a step two, which is migration, you can go and use data migration services. And then again, step-by-step, along with the screenshot, we are providing that information. Now, the best part on top of that is that along with this, from Data Migration Jumpstart Engineering, the best practices that we have got, we have also published those as part of this guide. So customers would be able to leverage those best practices along with the steps which are clearly outlined there. So which means even before reaching out to us, they have some place which kind of provide them step-by-step guidance to go and look at the migration use case scenario, be it from Oracle, be it from MySQL, DB2, and you name it.
Fantastic. Yeah. Thank you so much. Any concluding thoughts?
Well, I would, as I said, like from a migration perspective, I would want customers to understand that migrations are not, I would say, easy thought as a customer people have, but I would say after completing, I would say, thousands and thousands of migration through our program, we can very well assure you that it is not that tough also. You have to really understand what is the seasonality of your business, how critical your system is, and based on that, choose the right migration strategy and path along with your first party and third party toolings if required, and then you are good to go.
Fantastic. Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing these real world experiences with us.
Thank you for having me here, Sanjay.